Dear TYBSC physics students, now we are here in the chapter number 4, that is particle accelerators and detectors. In this particular chapter, we are going to learn this particular chapter in two different sessions. Session 1 will be concentrated on this particle accelerators, and session 2 will be based upon this particle detectors. Now, accelerators and detectors, these are certain devices which are used in nuclear physics. So, in that concern, an immediate question comes in our mind, why we need these type of devices or accelerators and detectors in nuclear physics? So, that is one very simple and common question for any learner who learns this nuclear physics. Friends, without these type of devices and these type of equipment that are used in nuclear physics, only theoretical nuclear physics would not be of any help unless it is supported by certain experiment and certain by certain facts. And these experiments and facts can be carried out with certain type of devices, that is called as the instrumentation, or that is called as the accelerators and the detectors too. Okay? So why instrumentation and devices needed in nuclear physics? So without that, if it is possible to understand the concepts of nucleus, the concepts of other associated concepts in nuclear physics, the answer is big no. No, in the sense, we won't be understand anything unless it is supported, it is experimented, it is demonstrated, it is tested, all the concepts, the theories and everything whatever we learned in nuclear physics, that will be in vain unless it is supported by certain equipment, certain experiments, demonstrations, device and so many things. Okay. So first paragraph, particle accelerators, this is one type, nuclear reactors, okay, where we generate energy from the nuclear reactions, then radiation detectors and computers. Nowadays, computer is also one of the very important and integral part of this nuclear instrumentation system too. So earlier it was not there, that means before 100 years, when this nuclear physics started flourishing, the computers were not there, but from 1980 onwards, 1990 onwards, these computers are helping a lot to understand all these concepts and the technology here. So these computers are the main tools nuclear physicists use to break up atoms. Okay, so breaking up atoms, making its part, as well as breaking up nucleus or looking inside into the nucleus into smaller particles and study their interactions and radioactivity and blah blah blah. Already lot many other concepts are there that can be studied, that can be understood with the help of this type of nuclear devices, which have been invented, discovered, designed, developed and being used by nuclear physicists from last 100 years or more than that. So this entire concept of such type of devices started with maybe before 100 years. So some primary type of devices were discovered, and nowadays this technology has almost reached up to its peak, which one can say, not at the not peak at all. Not we can say that peak, but it is reaching to a new standards and new heights day by day, which is having lot many applications in other fields too, not only nuclear physics, but other branches of science, other branches of commerce or the medicine, etc., industry, etc. These devices are playing very, very important and dominant role. In what way? So in that say, well, second paragraph tells you, the technological development of these devices has gone hand in hand with advances in nuclear sciences, sometimes leading and sometimes following closely behind. That meaning of this paragraph is that this advancements of theory, nuclear physics theory, and this particular technology or this instrumentation, these two things are going hand in hand. Sometimes theory goes ahead and then people go for searching for certain devices which will support this theory. Sometimes certain devices are there and that devices are making aware of us about something new which is not there in theory, and therefore theories are proposed. So that is what it is called as both of these, that means nuclear physics theory as well as this instrumentation part, that is nuclear physicist technology or nuclear technology, these two things are going hand in hand in such a manner. Sometimes one is leading and one is lagging, other times the first is lagging, second is leading. So these all these things are going hand in hand, and that's why we have reached to the particular stage of today's development that now we are quite able to understand this nucleus. Not again 100% understanding is possible nowadays too, but this particular technology and devices that have been introduced, developed and discovered by this nuclear physicist, these are found to be great importance for the human society. Not only in medical physics I am taking, but almost all branches of life, these type of devices are being used. So people say that, what is the use of this particular topic or the subject nuclear physics? It is not that. So technology that has been invented, technology that has been discovered by nuclear physicists from 100 years, this technology is playing a very, very important and large role in all walks of life. So that's what we have to understand this subject in this particular concern. And that is what we needed, this type of devices and instrumentation to understand and to elaborate our thinking about this type of nuclear reactions, nuclear particles, their behaviors, their properties, and lot many things as well. So technology and theory, theory and technology, they are going hand in hand. And that's why we are coming across different types of, day by day, lot many number type of other devices are being developed. These days, this ICT is again helping a lot to introduce such type of devices, their applications, their utilities, and so many things. So this is one very interesting and important future career for lot many science students. They can do their careers in this research of such type of devices, as well as they can become a trained person in operation of this type of devices, and thereby lot of employment can be generated throughout the world. And this is happening everywhere, not only in USA or some other high developed countries. In our country too, this type of devices, their designing, development, implementation, use, utilization, etc., all these things are happening at a large extent. So that is one opportunity for you all. Okay, now let's go for the first device here. As I said, that is called as particle accelerator. So before we start the actual devices learning here, we will start, what do you mean by particle accelerator? Now we understand the meaning of the word accelerator. So every vehicle has an accelerator. So whenever this accelerator is pushed, this vehicle gets more and more speed. So there is a clear-cut relation between operation of this accelerator and speed of the vehicle. Here the concept is again same. We are using these devices to increase the energy of certain particles, like alpha particles, beta particles, electrons, protons, or some other types of elementary particles. These particles are to be accelerated, or they have to be given more and more energy. So we are going towards more and more energy for these particles, and these particles are being used as a tool of investigation for further things. And that's what, this is what one very fundamental application, or the principle that all these accelerators are being used. So first paragraph, a particle accelerator is a machine that uses electromagnetic fields to propel or to accelerate. So word propel and accelerators are same meaning. Propel or accelerate charged particles to very high speeds or high energies, and to contain them in well-defined beam. So producing electron beam, producing proton beam, producing neutron beam, or producing some other type of elementary alpha particle beam, etc., with very, very high energy. Such type of, these are the tools, as I said. So we are preparing these tools of the particles with the help of these type of accelerators by providing more and more energy by using electromagnetic field. So this is the basic functioning of all types of accelerators. Now in that concern, the largest accelerator, okay, so when we go for study of all these accelerators, we have a very interesting spectrum of these accelerators, right from accelerator of 1 meter up to an accelerator of 30 kilometers, 40 kilometers length. So that is what second paragraph tells you. The largest accelerator currently operating is the Large Hadron Collider. Some of you might have heard earlier about this. This is called as LHC, near Geneva, Switzerland, operated by CERN. This is the Center for European Research in Nuclear. Yeah. Research Nuclear. So that is what the long form of this CERN. It is European Nuclear Energy Research Establishment. That is CERN. It is a collider accelerator which can accelerate two beams of protons to an energy of 6.5 TeV, tera electron volts. I'll just mention you what do you mean by this tera, and cause them to collide head on, creating a center of mass of energy almost up to 13 TeV. So this is the single largest operating type of accelerator, which is called as Large Hadron Collider. And see this energy, I think you might have heard about these words earlier. First one is when we have this 10 raised to 3, this power, this is called as kilo. Then 10 raised to 6, this is called as mega. Okay, that is mega unit we use. Then when we go for 10 raised to 9, well, okay, 1000 times of that. Sorry, this is 10 raised to 9. Then this is called as the this is called as giga, okay, giga, and this is what giga electron volt we have got. Then in 1000 times of that is 10 raised to 12, this is called as tera. Okay, so whatever number multiplied by 10 raised to 12, this much amount of energy can be associated or can be assigned to that particle which is coming out of this type of accelerator, and this energy is almost 13 TeV. So these such two protons with that much amount of energy, these are collided together and their interaction is studied, and that interaction gives lot of information about lot many type of other types of elementary particles and their interaction. So this entire exercise, as what we have seen, that is what one very simple and not simple but very complicated and advanced device which is working in this particular energy range. And please remember, there are currently more than, see the number, 30,000 different accelerators of different types, different technology, different generations, etc., are operation around the world. And just one very interesting thing here that I would like to tell you, that only 10% out of this, that means around 3000, 10% out of this are used for scientific purpose, for science research. And remaining 90% of these accelerators are used for different commercial purposes. So that is what the contribution of nuclear physics or nuclear physicists in the development of the world. So almost out of these 30,000 accelerators, different types of accelerators, only 10% are being used for the research, and almost 90%. So in all such type of labs or in the industries, in case of certain medical facility center, such type of accelerators are being used. So number is very, very large. There are several different types of companies all over the world, multinational companies working in the field of design, development and manufacturing, as well as operations of all these type of accelerators. And this is what one of the very big area for physics students, especially to go for a good careers in this type of fields, to provided you have a basic knowledge of all these things, and lot many things are there. So this is how that particular things tells you, out of these 30,000 accelerators operating in world, almost 90% are being used in the for the commercial purposes, lot many that we are going to discuss later on. So this is what as particle accelerators, and that is what one picture I'll show here, I'd like to show here. This is called as LHC, Large Hadron Collider. Now there are four photos I have seen here. This is the boundary. So this line shows you, this is said to be the boundary between two nations, and on this boundary of two nations, this is a orientation. This particular diameter of this is almost, or length of this particular is 30 kilometers. Okay, how much it is given there? It is almost 27 kilometers. So this much, this is an accelerator below the ground. Okay, all the details have been given. This is called as Large Hadron Collider, LHC, is the world's largest and highest energy particle collider by CERN in collaboration more than 100 countries. So almost 100 countries of the world, they came together, they collaborated, the technology, the financial aspects of all that, they have an agreement over that, and they have constructed and designed such type of oscillator, this type of accelerator, which is, see the size, it lies in a tunnel of 27 kilometers in circumference, and as deep as at a height of, or the depth, 175 meters beneath the France-Switzerland border near Geneva. So Geneva is one of the big city in Europe, it is in Switzerland, and close to that particular city, below that particular city, at a distance of 175 meters below the ground, this particular accelerator is at work. And you will see this is first picture shown here. This is shown to be one of this is a part of this accelerator. Okay, that is what this particular line you are seeing. this such line goes almost for a 27 kilometers. And if you are seeing, if you are able to see, the person standing here will be just of this much height, 5 or 6 feet or not more than that. But the height of this tunnel is almost few meters, maybe 25, 35 or 50 meters or more than that. And this entire device in a 27 kilometers in this big tunnel that has been operated, and look at how much energy would have been required for that, how much expenses would have been required for that, how much technology would have been required for that, and understanding all this purpose. So at one location, this is part circle shown here. This is one here, the detector has been kept, which is shown in this diagram. This detector where these two protons, so one proton comes from this side, another proton comes from this point side, and these two protons are several times, they are revolving around this particular type of accelerators, go increasing their energy, and at one stage these two protons are allowed to collide here in this operator, which is shown here. And here it has been photographed, this is to be photographed as shown by this diagram. Okay, so this is the actual site and its dimensions. This is the actual part of one part of this type of accelerator that is shown here. This is where this type of interaction is recorded and is seen, and it's recorded, and this is what this type of pictures are generated. This is again a computer simulation, this is not actual picture. So such type of interactions are, that means two protons are coming together from two different directions, there is a head-on collision is occurring with very high energy, and in that interaction several other types of elementary particles are generated, and we have to study all these particles, their interaction, and thereby we can study some other properties of nuclei and other materials and lot many things. So this is what as Large Hadron Collider, which is one of the very important accelerator in nowadays in the world, and maybe in future we'll be having accelerators bigger than these two, it is possible. So there are some other countries which are undergoing thinking about constructing such type of future accelerators. That means we are trying to increase this energy. Already we have seen this is 13 TeV, this much amount of energy we are assigning to these protons here. People are trying to increase this up to 100 TeV, more than that, or in that case, and as much amount of energy we are needed, much and much more amount of machinery is needed, technology is needed, amount is needed, and that business becomes a very, very huge business, or the entire exercise becomes very expensive when we go for constructions of such type of devices and their applications and too many. So this is one scientific type of accelerator which is called as Large Hadron Collider. Just keep this information where it is required for you whenever it is possible. So this is what type of accelerator we have seen. Now let's come to actual our types. Out of these four type of different type of accelerators, we are going to study this linear accelerator. Then we are going to study something about this cyclotron. It is a circular accelerator. These two are not in our syllabus, but remember there are four different types of such type of particle accelerators are there. Some are linear, that is these particles which are being accelerated, they follow a linear path. Some are the circular, that means some of the oscillators where the paths accelerators where particle follows the path which is going to be circular. So there is cyclotron, betatron, synchrotron, etc. All these are circular type of accelerators. So out of that, these two, linear accelerator and the cyclotron, these are the two devices we are going to discuss as follows here. Okay, let's go to the next. Now this is what called as the first type of accelerator, that is called as linear accelerator or LINAC. Okay, now let's see here. Now that tells you one very interesting thing. Linear high energy accelerator use a linear array of plates or drift tubes to which an alternating high energy field is applied. We are going to describe this, what happens in this particular diagram. As the particle approaches the plate, they are accelerated towards it by an opposite polarity charge applied to that plate. So that is its working part actually. As they pass through a hole in the plate, the polarity is switched so that the plate now repels them and they are now accelerated by it towards the next plate or next this particular type of cylinder shown here. Theoretically, that means theoretically one can generate LINAC of any length, so we can build any length. Practically, the largest linear accelerator being operated in at the Stanford University in US, and see the size, this is almost 3.2 kilometers. So from few meters to few kilometers, such type of devices also can be generated. There are a lot many. Out of that, one has been photographed here, which is called as Stanford University Linear Accelerators. Okay, that is what the diagram showing here. Now let's see its operation and all these things in the construction. So here, this is one source or ion source where this ion is generated. So the simulation tells you what happens actually there. Now these are the cylinders C1, C2, C3, C4, etc. And these cylinders are, now gap between these cylinders is same, whereas length of this cylinder goes on increasing in such a manner. Now this is to be operated in such a manner that these cylinders are connecting to alternate voltage or alternate current or alternate supply, EC source. That source is alternating source where its polarity is being changed. So plate, the cylinder number 1, 3, 5, etc. all are connected together. And the cylinder number 2, 4, 6, etc. these are connected to one connection here. So here, whenever this polarity of this particular EM electromagnetic signal changes, sometimes this becomes negative, this is positive, this is at the same time, this is negative, this is positive. So alternatively, these type of cylinders, they become positive and negative. And thereby, whenever this particular type of particle is released by this ion source here, if it is a positively charged particle, when this becomes a negative, this will get accelerated and then it passes through this particular cylinder. When it reaches at this edge, within that time, this polarity of this next cylinder has been changed. So it becomes now positive and this particle will be now accelerated towards it. Provided if this particle emitted is now negative by this source here, then this will be accelerated towards positive plate. Then it will travel through here. After when it reaches here, now it will be accelerated by this plate. And within this journey, this gap itself, it is accelerated. And when it is passing through this particular tube, it drifts with a velocity uniform here. So velocity here is different, re-increases. Now again, velocity here, whatever increased velocity with this particle goes here. At this end, when it reaches here, again, it receives a next push by changing this electric field. It gains its energy. And next time also its energy increases. So this time its velocity is now V3. So we are having velocities V1 less than V2 is less than V3 less than V4. So this velocity goes on increasing as and when this type of charge particle goes through these type of different drip tubes. And that is how when it reaches from first to second, velocities increase. From reaches second to third, velocities increase. Say third to fourth, velocities increase. And from fourth to nth, whatever number of here, that will find you this velocity of that particle goes on increasing. And that's how it gains more and more amount of energy. And whatever energy of this incident particle here, when it comes out of this particular operation of this particular type of accelerator, energy received by that particle is very, very enormous, or its kinetic energy will be very, very high because its velocity is going to be very, very large. So this synchronization is to be occur. And for this synchronization, that means direction of electric field and the movement of the particle, charge particle inside these tubes, that is to be synchronized. And this synchronization is achieved by varying the length of this C1, C2, C3, C4, etc. These lengths go on increasing as it has been shown in this particular diagram. So see that particular shows, this particular Vx shows here. This is the value of this potential here. Potential becomes positive and negative alternatively, and thereby this particle is being accelerated. So this particle emitted by this source, accelerated again, in this gap only when this particular electric field changes its direction. And when it is passing through this particular cylinder, velocity of that particle is found to be constant. That means, for example, when it is reaching here and it is coming here, this velocity is uniform. But when it goes out of this and enters into another tube, then its particular energy goes on increasing. This way, step by step, to cylinder 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc., we are increasing their energy. And at the end, when this particle comes out of this particular device, it gains a lot of amount of energy. And now this particle is allowed to interact with for the further reaction, which is to be under study. So thereby, ordinary particles which are not having that much amount of energy with which we can carry out certain types of nuclear reactions, some type of special nuclear reactions can be carried out by increasing kinetic energy of such type of alpha particles, beta particles, or like all type of charged particles. And thereby these particles are now used as a probing tools for studying further type of nuclear reaction. So this is the operation of this type of accelerator, which is called as linear accelerator. In short, it is called as LINAC. Okay, so this is called as LINAC. Now let's go to some of its mathematical part. This particular slide tells you how this operation goes on, what is its construction, etc., and what is the biggest type of such type of linear accelerator at present existing in world. Okay, now let's come to this particular one slide here that tells you how what we are going to calculate here in this case. Now length of the n cylinder is so chosen, that is what I said, synchronization, that the particle will spend time is equal to half period of this AC signal. So whatever AC signal here, this is the time required, capital T. Half of this is going to be capital T upon 2. So this much time that particular particle will spend inside that particular type of cylinder of increasing length. Accordingly, we have to select this particular length such that this particle will spend a time is equal to half period of this AC signal. That is what the condition for synchronization is given. Half period, which is given to be 1 upon 2f, T is the period, so T by 2, T is 1 upon f, so T is 1 upon f, half of that will be 1 upon 2f, is equal to length of that cylinder divided by velocity with which that charged particle is traveling through this cylinder. That means if it is the nth cylinder, ln is length, and whenever it is passing through this particular particle cylinder, then vn is the velocity. Then likewise, I can go for l1 upon v1, likewise I can go for l2 upon v2, then again go for l3 upon v3, and like that. So length of first cylinder, its velocity inside that, second cylinder velocity inside that, third cylinder its velocity of the particle inside that. That way this particular thing is to be approached in such a manner, it will be always equal to 1 upon twice f. That means as velocity is increased, length of this is going to be increased. If velocity v2 is more, l2 will be more, velocity v3 is more, l3 is still more than that, and that's how this length of that particular consecutive cylinder goes on increasing as this velocity goes on increasing. So this calculation tells you how to go for this simple calculation. So where ln is the length of n cylinder plus gap between previous. Okay, so that's what in our earlier diagram we have drawn. This is my first cylinder, this is the second cylinder. So ln is taken from this gap plus length of this. This is my L2, this is simply L1. When I go from second to third, this is gap and this is third cylinder. So from this to this, this is given to be L3. Likewise, this ln is calculated as the length of the n cylinder plus gap between previous. So earlier two consecutive cylinders, gap plus actual length of the cylinder, that is taken to be ln, or length of that particular cylinder. Okay, actual physical length is different, length to be taken in calculation is different. That is to be calculated by measuring the gap between these two cylinders plus actual length of the cylinder. That gives you particular value of that length of that particular cylinder, which is used in this calculation. So therefore, from this formula I can get ln is equal to, just adjust this, it is vn upon twice f. So that is expression. Now when this particle, if it is accelerated, now if v0 is the average potential difference between successive cylinders, then nth cylinder energy gained by that charged particle, it is given by, there are two factors, this is E into v0, that is what electrostatic energy gained by this particle. Since we are in the nth cylinder, so this is n times E into v0 plus c. C is called as initial injection velocity. That means that whatever charge particle emitted by that ion source of that particular source, it must have certain minimum velocity, and that is to be taken into consideration here. So this n times E into V0 energy gain plus C is equal to whatever amount of kinetic energy that is given by 1 by 2, is what expression, classical expression we use here, 1 by 2 m into Vn square. So that is Vn is the velocity of that charge particle when it is traveling through this nth cylinder, it is given by Vn. So 1 half into its mass into Vn square, that gives me kinetic energy. And this kinetic energy is nothing but addition of these two energy. Out of that, this is fixed one, constant one, injected energy, energy of the particle. And this n times E into V0, that is what electrostatic energy gained by this particle when it is entered in the nth cylinder. Now, if it is n minus 1, earlier to that, it will be n minus 1 into E into V0 plus 1 half, or plus C is equal to 1 by 2 m into V n minus 1 square. Like what? That means for each and every cylinder, I can calculate expression for its energy, which is given by this. Now solving this, I'll get Vn is equal to root of twice Ne into V0 plus C upon m, that is the square root. We'll get this expression for velocity of the particle that is coming out of this n cylinder as shown by this. Here C is the injected velocity. So that is what injected velocity of the particle when it enters in the first cylinder. And therefore, we can go for this expression. I have got this expression. Ln is equal to Vn upon twice n. I got this Vn is equal to root of twice Ne V0 plus C upon m. Therefore, Ln can be calculated by Ln is equal to 1 upon twice F. Same expression. Write this Vn there. It is square root of twice n into Ve into V0 plus C divided by small m, where m is mass of that charged particle, n is the number of cylinder, E is the charge of that particular particle, V0 is the potential difference between two such types of cylinder, C is the injected velocity, and this F is nothing but frequency of that frequency of that oscillator, oscillating source or AC source, which is connected across these cylinders, A1, 3, 5, 7, etc., and 2, 4, 6, etc. That common connection gives you the type of frequency of that type of additions. And therefore, we also know that there is one expression for this in physics, that is C is equal to F into lambda. So frequency into wavelength, that gives you velocity or the wave velocity also, or here in this case, in case of this AC signal, we can write this expression, C is equal to F times lambda. Therefore, rearranging this 1 upon twice F. So make it 1 upon twice F here. Take F here, it will F 1 upon F. C we have to be taken here, multiplied by 1 by 2. So we'll get 1 upon twice F. It will become lambda upon 2C. So I can replace this 1 upon 2F from this lambda upon 2C. So when it is replaced there, lambda will remain outside. Take this 2C inside the square bracket. So it is to be made to be 4 times C square. So small C square remains there, that is velocity of light. And this one of those two will get cancelled. And therefore, final expression I'll get, ln is equal to lambda times square root of n into e multiplied by v0 plus c divided by twice mc square. So that decides what should be the length of that particular type of cylinder which we are taking in consideration. And that is here, this n is the number that is to be in my hand. We can have a constant value for that. E charge of that particular particle which is being accelerated, that is fixed. V0, that is fixed. This c, injectable velocity, that is again to certain extent can be called to be fixed. Twice is fixed, m mass of that particle is also fixed, and c, that is the velocity of light, c square. So everything in this square root bracket is fixed except this lambda, and that's what the total length of accelerator is proportional to lambda of radio frequency of AC signal. That means depending upon this lambda, its wavelength, this particular length of that particular type of cylinder goes on increasing. And that's what this type of relationship tells you, how this type of accelerator, which is called as linear accelerator, it works, and how to define or how to find out its length of a particular cylinder based upon its the source which we are connecting across this. So more frequency source which we are connecting, that length of that will go on increasing. And this relationship has been shown by this expression, ln is equal to lambda. Everything is constant there. So ln is directly proportional to lambda. Okay. So this particular relationship is found there. And whenever this type of particles comes out of that particular type of last cylinder, then its energy is found to be very, very high as compared to its initial energy. And this type of energetic particle can be used for further processes, as we already seen, for maybe for commercial purpose, for research purpose, for in nuclear reactions, carrying out some different types of nuclear reactions, or many, depending upon choice of your application. You can have any application associated with that particle which is accelerated through this type of operator, which is called as linear accelerator or linear accelerator. So this is what one important device we have to study. Then now we'll go for the second. This is called as cyclotron. Now there is a bit difference between the working of cyclotron and this particular LINAC or linear accelerator. A linear accelerator is a device where this particle travels in a linear path, in a line, okay, from one cylinder to second cylinder, second to third, and like that. So it travels a path through a line and it gets an energy. In spite of that, this linear accelerator, this cyclotron is called as LINAC wrapped into a tight spiral pipe. So in spite of linear path, this charged particle is allowed or are compelled to travel inside a circular path. And after every completion of one circle, its energy is to be increased And whenever it comes out of this, whenever it is taken out of this, after this coming out this particle, its particle is found to be have maximum kinetic energy or more kinetic energy, and thereby this is accelerated and it can be further used for different purposes. So such type of devices, which is called as such type of cyclotron, first device was developed, designed and developed by Ernest O. Lawrence in 1939. And for that very important discovery, this scientist received Nobel Prize in 1939. And look the diagram, the first diagram I have shown here. This is what the person, here is the person, that is Ernest Lawrence, and see his height and see the entire device which we have seen here. Okay, so these are the actual D's here. We are going to see the actual explanation part there. These are certain apparatus required there in the case. So construction and development of such type of cyclotron is not that easy. It again requires lot much technological knowledge, engineering knowledge, not many other types of systems are required, and then it becomes a such type of the accelerator, or that is called as cyclotron. So this is what Lawrence 60-inch cyclotron, 60-inch means 5 feet, with magnet poles 60 inches. Okay, these are the magnet poles 5 feet and 1.5, that is 1.5 meters in diameter. So these are the very big electromagnets having their size to be around 1.5 meter diameter. At the University of California, Lawrence Radiation Laboratory, Berkeley, in August 1939. And this, that was the one of the most powerful accelerator in the world at that time. Nowadays, this LHC and all that things, this have changed the entire scenario. And people are now constructing a bigger and bigger energetic oscillators, which we are going to discuss later on. So this was the first type of cyclotron accelerator, which was developed and designed by Ernest Lawrence in 1939. And this is what the development, this is what the diagram tells you, how big this apparatus is there as compared to human height and so on. So this is an actual photo of this type of accelerator, which was developed by Lawrence in the Berkeley as in the 1939. So that was, this is one interesting sight. Now let's come to this construction and working. These are the two diagrams which have been given here. We'll just this here. There are two back-to-back D's. Okay, D. This is English D-shaped. Okay, this is one actually cavity, and there is one more. These two cavities are kept like this. Okay, backing each to back to back. These one D is here, which is what we use in, and its mirror image is kept left side to that. Then this type of apparatus is to be arranged as shown in this diagram there. So we'll read this first. Two back-to-back D's, hollow chambers, diametric edges, parallel and slightly separated, as shown by in the second diagram. Okay, back-to-back these D's. These are slightly separated from each other. Ion source, usually proton. Okay, in earlier case we could have used electron. Here we have to use, this is a proton or positively charged particle. This is kept at the center. A gap between the D's, and this particular two D's are to be connected with high frequency accelerating voltage or AC source. Okay, so high frequency AC, high means ultra high frequency, radio frequency or ultra high frequency source is to be connected across these two D's. That's why as it changes its polarity, the polarity of this also changes from plus, minus, minus, plus, etc. And in this gap, whatever gap existing, this electric field changes its direction as this polarity of these two D's changes. And now this is to be again synchronized here. So high frequency AC source is connected across. Alternating electric field between the gap that exists, depending upon the frequency of the source here, the rate of altercation depends upon what is the frequency of this particular source we have connected here. Whole apparatus, this entire apparatus is to be kept between two large electromagnets, that is shown here. This is one electromagnet and this is another. If it is N pole, then this is S pole. This type of magnetic field is to be taken perpendicular to these two D's at what we have seen here. So this is these D's, these are kept in between these two electromagnets. That is what earlier diagram also that clearly seen. So that is what a, this is what a particle source. This is the spiral beam with the path. These are the two circular cavities what we have seen earlier here. This is the target over which this particular particle is to be incident, and this is what exit beam. So when it comes out, then it is to be taken out from this oscillator, from this particular disk, and then it comes out and it strikes this target which is kept for the study and all these things. So now let's see here. So So this magnetic field direction is perpendicular to the plane of the disc. So that is shown either up, you can have any perpendicular direction, directing from lower blade to lower magnet to upper magnet, or from upper magnet to lower magnet, depending upon their polarities. And strong field compels the particle to circulate in a path of increasing radius. That is what you might have heard or you might have seen, the charged particle in electric and magnetic field. When a charged particle is thrown in a magnetic field, which is in the direction perpendicular to the direction of the magnetic field, it undergoes a circular motion. So this concept of classical mechanics, you might have studied earlier, this can be used in this case to compel this charged particle emitted by this ion source here, which is kept in between. And this charged particle is compelled to go for circle of increasing radius. Now, why increasing radius? Every time when it reaches this gap, it gains energy, and whenever its energy is gained, it goes for higher circles. When again comes here, its energy will be increased, then it goes for higher radius. Again, same thing repeats here as and when it crosses this gap. In this gap, it gains energy, and because of that, it has to travel in a higher radius. And as this, when we go for this entire path, this path becomes circular path. And finally, when it reaches to a boundary of this, it is to be accelerated, or you have to apply certain negative potential here. Because of that, it changes its path, and then it comes out with which is called as a high speed proton beam. So because of this interaction between this negative field and this particular charge, positive charge particle, this particle can be taken out from this spiral, and then it is further useful for any other purposes. So this is what a construction and working of this type of device, which is called as cyclotron. Now, once we understand the cyclotron, let's go for its functioning or its working principle. So that is working of cyclotron. Due to perpendicular magnetic field, the centripetal force acting on charged particle, as we have just now discussed, which is given by M1V1, since it is in the first radii, first circle, that is M1V1 square upon R1 is equal to BQV. Now, this expression directly comes from this Lorentz equation. We can directly go for that. That implies, that tells me how to calculate radius of first orbit, that is R1 is equal to M into its velocity in the first orbit for the first time, that is V1 divided by B into Q. Note here, M, B and Q, all these three numbers are constant. M is mass, Q is this charge, B is the magnetic field which we have, which we are operating there. So this radius and V1 or this velocity, that is a reciprocity, that means as this radius and that is proportionality, that as we go for higher and higher radius, the velocity of the particle will be more and more. So R1, V1, then in the second radius R2, we will have V2 and like that. So this velocity goes on changing. So where these numbers have been given, M is the mass of the ion, B is magnetic field strength, and V1 is the velocity of the ion. Now, for every circular path, as we have seen, this ratio omega is equal to V upon R. So this is a relationship between linear velocity, radius and angular velocity. This relation omega is equal to V upon R. That implies if I write this relation for R is equal to M into V upon B into Q. So I can write this relation here is equal to R upon V is equal to M upon BQ. So I can write this relationship, and taking its reciprocal or its inverse, I'll write omega is equal to BQ upon M. So BQM, everything is constant. So here, angular velocity depends upon the field strength B, charge to mass ratio of the given particle Q upon M. And that's how, once I select this type of device, or one constructed this type of device, the angular velocity of the path that is to be circular, or that is to undergo a circular motion inside this disc, that is going to be a constant that depends upon the magnetic field strength and charge to mass ratio of the particle. So if it is an electron, this omega will be different. If it is a proton, again this Q by M will be different. For a given type of field, this omega will be different. So depending upon different types of charge particle which you are using here, that this omega may be varying, and that is given by BQ upon M. So that it depends upon this charge to mass ratio, as well as depends upon the magnetic field strength that has been provided by these two bar magnets. So when particle reaches an edge of the disc, as we have seen in the earlier diagram, field direction changes, giving a kick and additional kinetic energy to the particle, resulting higher radius of the path. When it reaches a periphery, last orbit is there, it is deflected by negative potential difference, and comes out of the spiral to bombard on target that is shown in the earlier diagram. So this is one basic working of this. Now I can further, these type of relations can be understood. So in this process, what is the amount of energy that ion or that charged particle which is given by this ion source, that can be calculated. So again, we have to use the same expression, PQV is equal to mv square upon r. Now here, from this relation, I can write v square is equal to, simple, this relation, one of this v can be cancelled, dqv will be cancelled, so mv upon r will be there. So I can write v is equal to bq into r upon m. Making a square, I'll get v square q square r square upon m square. And as we know that this v square is required for calculating kinetic energy of any of the particle in the classical limits, it is given by 1/2 m into v square. So kinetic energy of the particle which is being used in this case, this is given by v square q square r. Now this r is the last radius, or the radius of the last path, largest path. That's how it is given by capital R. That is actually the dimensions of the size of the d. Size of the d or radius of that d is again given to be R, capital R. So it cap maximum energy capital E is equal to b square q square into r square divided by twice m. This is what the energy we can generate or we can give to this charged particle. And here, when particle or ion is accelerated through potential difference V, it acquires kinetic energy by this electrostatic relation, which is given by E is equal to Q into V. So from these two relations, this and this, I can find out how much amount of potential difference required there to have a synchronization there. That's what, equating both of these equations for E, I can write V square R square upon twice M is equal to this QV, and from that one gets relation for capital V is equal to V square, that is magnetic field strength square, Q, that is the charge of the particle, R square, that is the radius of that dipolar D, and divide by twice M. So here we can write this equation for velocity, this potential difference, V is equal to V square Q into R square upon twice M, and that's what, for resonance. So see here, we are not allowed to take any arbitrary field. We have to set this field such that this will occur a resonance. Resonance means that the polarity of the field will go on changing. Polarity of this electric field will go on changing as per the frequency of frequency of this particular source which is connected across two disks, and the motion of that particle. That means for a particular direction of the field, this field, that particular particle should be in half d. While it is reaching in the next d, second d, the polarity in between would have been changed. So that is called as synchronization. So for the resonance, time of our particle journey inside d must be equal to half the time period capital T of this oscillation. Here again, pi upon omega. Pi is the, said to be the, this angular distance, pi. And omega is the velocity, so pi upon omega is the time required. So this pi upon omega must be equal to period of that AC signal which we have been connected there. It is T upon 2, so that is what AC signal I am connected. This is again T upon 2, and this T upon 2, and this time that is required for half journey divided by omega, that must be equal. So that is what we are equating this. Pi upon omega is equal to 2 upon 2, and therefore here also we know that frequency of that is given by n is equal to 1 upon t, that is reciprocal of the period, and therefore we can write expression for n is equal to, from this we can adjust this, we can get omega upon twice pi. So n is equal to omega upon twice pi, and therefore cyclotron resonant frequency, we have already seen expression for this omega. Omega is nothing but b into q upon m. That is what we have seen. This is a fix for a particular apparatus given for a particular charge type of particles. So bq upon m, and therefore resonating frequency of that oscillator or that cyclotron is given by accelerator. Cyclotron is given by n is equal to bq upon twice m. That indicates this frequency is also going to be a constant, provided there is a magnetic field strength is a constant there. But we have to see that this magnetic field strength should be such that there will be a synchronized motion. There won't be any asynchronization. Where there is an asynchronization, then this particle will not undergo in such type of circular motion, and it will not have attained a desired type of energy there. So to have this type of synchronization, we have to adjust this magnetic field in such a manner. This operation of this particular accelerator will be very, very smooth. and the particle or the charged particle which is coming out of that particular D or that apparatus will attain a certain fixed amount of energy there. Okay, so this equation, the equation for N, tells you not dependent upon radius of the D's or velocity of the ion. So that neither V appears there nor this R appears in this relation. So this is independent of both of this. Then the higher the frequency, the required, the stronger B magnetic field strength is required for resonance. So that means if I am increasing the frequency of this AC source more and more magnetic field will be required to satisfy this condition for resonance, and thereby this amount of energy generated or acquired by this particle will be made more and more. So this is what a working and the mathematics associated with that. Remember, here in this case we have not considered for an electron. If it is an electron, is the charged particle there, this shows when some variation in its mass when we go for this relativistic effect. So in the relativistic effect, mass of this particle goes on increasing. It is going by 1 minus v square upon c square. When this v increasing approaching toward this c, m goes on increasing, and since this m is here, this resonating frequency may go on reducing. So there is a practical limit with which how much energy one can assign to this electron through this type of accelerator or this cyclotron, and therefore there is a practical limit within relativistic theory. If this mass of the electron increasing appreciably, then this type of device is not capable of giving energy to this electron. But sometimes if I use proton or some other alpha particles, etc., then the masses of these particles are much bigger, and for a particular set of the magnetic field, their frequency can be maintained very nicely. So this device has to be worked in the limit of this relativistic effect. If this mass of this that whenever relativistic effect comes in picture, then this device have certain limitations. So that can be understood from its theory and all that things. Okay, so this is what the second type of device and its working and functional. And now we'll go for the last slide here, that is called as applications of these accelerators. Now what are these applications? We'll learn by one by one. I hope you would have understood these are the two different types of accelerator. One is linear accelerator, LINAC. Second is circular accelerator, that is cyclotron. Usually, as I said, cyclotron is used for alpha particles, protons, like positively charged particles. For electron increasing or the accelerating electron to a higher and higher energy, we require another device, that is called as this betatron. And some other cases, advanced version of that is called as synchrotron, which is not in our syllabus, so we are not studying these devices here. So once we understand these two devices and their working, let's come to the last part of this discussion, that is their application. So first and very common application of that is medicine. High energy beams, okay, so whatever beams or the electron beam, beta rays, etc., what we have seen, or this alpha ray, etc., if these beams, they can be used for killing tumors. So in cancer treatment, this type of tumors can be killed with the help of this high energy type of particles, which are being accelerated by these type of devices, which are called as accelerators. So in hospitals, you might have seen certain, wherever this cancer treatment goes on, there such type of instruments have been kept in somewhere, that this particular person is to be exposed, that the patient is to be exposed for a particular type of beam for a particular type of duration. That is that these things are to be decided by the doctors or the operators who operate over at that particular stages. There are several tests and everything where has to go, and this killing of tumors is possible with the help of such type of high energy beams, which have been accelerated or have been given more and more energy with the help of this type of accelerator. So this is one very interesting and fundamental application of nuclear physics tools or devices or technology into the medical field. Then used to generate radioisotopes. So these particles which are accelerated, which have gained a large amount of energy, these particles can be bombarded with other lighter nuclei, and that nuclei can be changed into radioisotopes. That is called as induced radioactivity. So used to generate radioisotopes induced, that can be used in radiotherapy as biological as well as industrial tracers. So several different types of tracers, iodine, then silicon, aluminium, etc. Every element can be made radioactive by these type of particles. They are to be taken as intact by that particular patient by certain foods, and their interactions are to be studied. And this entire application of this is one of the application of this type of accelerators, which are able to generate such type of radioisotopes using this type of technique. As in research, already we have discussed for this LHC. In research, studying internal structure of atom and nuclei. So this type of very high energy particles, they are to be strike over the nucleus as well as atom, and thereby we have to photograph them. We have to study the particles generated in this process, and thereby study of these atoms and their structures and nuclei structures if possible with the help of these type of high energy beams. Then the most powerful machines, as already we have discussed, exceeding 1 GeV, giga electron volt, used in particle interactions. That's what large hadron colliders, or there are so many others, other types of devices which are using this energy to be more than 1 giga electron volt. And these energy particles are used to study the particle, different types of particle interactions. And as I said in the last previous chapter, we have shown that there are hundreds of such type of elementary particles are existing, though their lifetime is very, very small. But such type of particles are generated in such type of reactions, and their study is possible. And therefore, this is one of the very important application. Then, as I said, violent particle collisions mimic. Mimic means we are producing these pictures in the laboratory with the help of such type of devices, or the such type of high energy particles. They are striking with each other, head-on collision. And in that process, some very, very fundamental and elementary particles are generated. And whatever happened at the time of Big Bang, such type of situations are being created at a small scale in the laboratory, and thereby we are trying to understand these Big Bang theory or Big Bang concepts of the Big Bang theory. So that's what violent particle collisions mimic, the conditions just after the Big Bang. That is what happening inside this large hadron collider, and which helps us in understanding all these things what we have discussed earlier case. And this is what this entire thing helps us in scientific understanding of makeup of the universe, how this universe has been created, or how it has been generated, how it has been developed, what are the different stages of development. Everything can be understood with all these things. Okay, so here we have finished this session one, where we have discussed these two different types of accelerators. One is called as LINAC, second is called as cyclotron. We have seen their construction, their functioning, their applications, etc. All these things we have discussed in detail in the previous in this particular session. So thank you for watching. Thank you for being me for this entire session, and that will help us a lot, many things there. Okay, thank you all.